morning, and may it please the Court. Audra Lim on behalf of Appellants Duke and David Yocom. With the Court's permission, I'd like to reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal.
All right, keep an eye on the clock.
Will do. This case presents two issues. First, the Yocoms have adequately pleaded that the government violated their due process rights under this Court's precedent in Ching v. Mayorkas. The government determined that Duke's prior marriage to T.L. was fraudulent without providing an opportunity to cross-examine critical witnesses. The complaint alleges that the key evidence supporting the marriage fraud determination was the result of an immigration officer making a highly coercive threat to out Duke to his wife, T.L.
Just a minute, Ms. Lim. Let's take basic procedural steps. This is a 12B6 motion. District Court granted it. That means you haven't alleged, according to District Court, sufficient facts which are plausible to frame a cause of action for the cross-examination you seek. Just now, you made a claim that the actions of the immigration officers were coercive, right?
Correct.
Where in your complaint are facts alleged which make it plausible that there was coercion?
2 points in response to that. So both the complaint and its attachments, there's a declaration from Duke where he explains exactly what happened in the immigration interview and describes the immigration officer making this threat to reveal his sexual orientation to TL. I also think the amicus brief filed in this case provides really critical context. On pages 20 to 24, that brief explains why a threat to out someone is so coercive. It explains that someone's sexual orientation is a private.
I'm not so interested in the argumentation that's closing up the amicus brief yet. What I'm interested in is what facts were alleged that make the actions of the immigration officer coercive. For instance, was there any allegation that the immigration officer yelled and screamed at these two persons? No. Is there any allegation that the immigration officer threatened either one with criminal prosecution or other government action? No. I think what you're saying, if I understand you correctly, is that the presence of an immigration officer with these two persons and the allegations of the complaint that the immigration officer told T.L. to sign the statement she had redacted, that constituted coercion. Plus the fact that the immigration officer said, "Shall I tell her or will you tell her about what apparently was unknown homosexuality of Duck?" Right? Is that the basis of your coercion statement?
So the basis of our coercion statement does rely heavily on the immigration officer saying to Duck, "I am going to out you to your wife, T.L., whom you have never shared this highly shameful secret with." It also consists of, after that, Duke becoming extremely embarrassed and humiliated, and the immigration officer then continuing to insist that his marriage to T.L. was fraudulent, even as he tried to explain otherwise. The complaint alleges that he tried to tell the immigration officer, "No, I'm not going to take her out later and pay her for this marriage." That's not what's happening. And still, the immigration officer kept insisting that their marriage was fraudulent.
And what you're seeking is a reversal and remand with instructions that a evidentiary hearing be allowed at which you can cross-examine T.L., correct?
What we're seeking at this stage is a reversal so it can go back to the district court and continue to be litigated, because we're at the motion to dismiss stage. All that would happen upon reversal is that we would continue being able to litigate this claim in district court. So this court is not being asked to decide whether we are in fact entitled to cross-examination.
What you're really seeking is to cross-examine T.L. and the immigration officer, I take it.
Yes, we are seeking to cross-examine both of them.
All right. Is there anything in the record from T.L. that indicates that she felt coerced? And if so upon what facts?
So a reasonable inference from the complaint is that what happened from TL's?
Pardon me. You had attachments to the complaint. You had a declaration from Mr. Duck. There was no declaration from TL, correct?
Correct. There was no declaration from TL, but I actually think that's consistent with their marriage being bona fide. If you look at things from her perspective, what happened is that she married Duck, intending to establish a life with him, intending to be married to him, and then found out in pretty bad circumstances that her husband was actually gay, and then ended up divorcing him. And in those circumstances, you might think that she might not be willing to help Duck.
It's a supposition on your part. Is there any declaration or any part of the record saying that you attempted to get a declaration from TL saying that the tone of the voice of the immigration officer and the fact that the immigration officer asked her, shall I tell him or are you going to tell him, that coerced her or was it some element of duress against her?
So 2 points in response to that. There's nothing in the record that shows whether or not we tried to get a declaration from TL. Again, I do think at the motion to dismiss stage, the court is required to draw all reasonable inferences in the plaintiff's favor. And I think the inferences you can draw here is that what happened from her perspective is that there was an immigration interview that was going just fine. She saw the officer make some sort of very serious threat towards her husband, saw her husband start to shake, break down, become humiliated, saw that the officer was determined to find that their marriage was fraudulent, and then ended up succumbing to that threat.
What relief are you seeking here? I mean, if we send it back down and you can amend, what relief would you like to have?
So at the end of the day, we would like, on the due process claim, cross-examination of TL and the officer. If you send it back, what would happen, I think, is that there would be discovery on this claim and it would continue being litigated. So it wouldn't be an automatic cross-examination at this point. We would just continue.
Counsel, Judge Gould, if I could interject a question. If you've completed your answer to Judge Seiler.
Yes.
Is a motion for summary judgment can be filed at any time in the proceedings. So as I would understand it, if you persuade our court to reverse the dismissal on the pleading stage and remand for further proceedings, the appellee would be free to move for summary judgment and require you to submit some affidavits or declarations along the lines of what Judge Bea was inquiring about. But for now, we're only looking at the pleadings. So what did the pleading itself allege on this issue of coercion?
So what the pleading itself alleged is that the immigration officer looked at Duke's phone, saw pictures that made her realized that he was gay, threatened to tell his wife, TL, that he was gay, something that he had never told her before, something he had not shared with anyone, something that was a tremendous source of shame for him, given the conditions of where he grew up in Vietnam, and given how his family had been really pressuring him to marry a woman. But after the officer made that threat to Duck, he started to become embarrassed, basically went into a state of shock. And it was sort of when he was in that state of shock that the officer kept insisting that they weren't a couple. The complaint alleges that she asked questions about whether they were a couple, but then answered them herself and insisted that they weren't, even as Duck tried to explain, no, he wasn't paying TL for marriage. And so what the complaint alleges is that you have this very serious and extreme threat to share something that's incredibly personal and incredibly for Duke a source of shame, and then followed by the officer continuing to apply pressure until both of them succumbed. And signed statements saying that their marriage was fraudulent. And those circumstances that are pleaded in our complaint, the court must accept as true. And I think it shows an incredibly high risk of erroneous deprivation when the key evidence that the agency is relying upon was both taken under coercive conditions and where the complaint alleges the evidence actually is false.
Okay, thanks, counsel. I think you answered my question. You just would like us to send this back to the district court so that the proceedings can follow, that it's not dismissed on the pleadings.
Yes, that is correct. We're just asking this court to dismiss based on what's in the pleadings. If that happens, this will go back. An evidentiary record will be created, and then at that point, either side or both sides can move for summary judgment. And I'll just add that that's actually the posture in which Chang and other cases involving these sorts of issues have come before this court. This court hasn't had very many cases since Chang requesting cross-examination under Chang, but a lot of them have arisen in the summary judgment posture, which does seem like an appropriate posture in which to litigate these issues.
Are you seeking money damages in this case or some sort of an injunctive relief?
At this point, all we're seeking is for, one, the due process claim to be reversed, and then with the ultimate goal of getting cross-examination, and then separately, independently on the APA claim. What we're ultimately seeking, I think, is for this case to be sent back to the agency, and what we say in our complaint is that we are entitled to a grant of the I-130 petition based on what is in the record. And so that's really the ultimate goal here, is for David's I-130 petition to be granted so that Duke can then apply for adjustment to lawful permanent resident status and be able to remain lawfully permanently in the country with his spouse.
Let me ask you, do any of your allegations state that T.L. felt coerced? You stated that Ducks got nervous and started shaking or was embarrassed. But as to T.L., I don't see any allegations that T.L. was embarrassed or shaking or in any way coerced or under duress.
2 points in response to that. So at the motion to dismiss stage, it's not just the allegations that have to be accepted as true, but reasonable inferences from them. And so the reasonable inference here is that what T.L. saw was that her husband received this very serious threat that caused him to go into a state of shock, that the officer kept insisting that they weren't a couple, and that she felt pressured to succumb to the narrative. I will also say that if the court grants us leave to amend, we can absolutely add more specific allegations.
Did you ask for leave to amend below?
I believe we did, and the district court denied. In either way, the district court did say that we are not allowed to amend the complaint, so it is something that the district court did consider. And because the district court did rule on it, I think it would be appropriate for this court to reverse on that basis, too.
And the complaint that the district court dismissed on the pleadings was the first complaint you filed.
That's correct. It's just the one complaint, Judge Gold.
You never had a chance to amend even once.
We have never amended the complaint. And again, I'll note that I see that my time is up.
We'll give you 2 minutes.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Tavro.
Good morning, Your Honor. Tristan Tavro on behalf of USCIS. This court should affirm the district court's order dismissing the complaint for failure to state a claim because David and Dr. Yocom, and apologies if I'm misstating his name.
Well, would you have to repeat because you were looking down and speaking and you didn't pronounce your words adequately. So try again.
Certainly, Your Honor.
Take your time, Mr. Darrow.
The court should affirm the order of the district court dismissing the complaint for failure to state a claim. The Yocoms received the process they were due, and they failed to plausibly allege an APA violation. In this case, the district court was presented with two smoking gun sworn statements by Duck and his former wife, T.L., claiming that they were just friends, that they never lived together, and that they married solely so that Duck could obtain a green card.
But those statements, as I read the complaint, were typed out by the immigration officer on her computer and then printed, correct? As to T.L.?
As to T.L., Ducks was handwritten.
Right. And then she put it to T.L. to sign the statement, and T.L. did so.
I believe that is how it is alleged. However,
and then after she signed the statement, she turned to Duck and she said, write out your statement, follow what T.L. wrote out, copy that, correct?
Those are the allegations. Right. Correct, Your Honor.
Don't you think that indicates some sort of overbearing duress?
No, Your Honor. Even if that is procedurally how it played out, the complaint doesn't offer any plausible allegations as to why TL would agree to sign and ratify such a statement, claiming marriage fraud, exposing herself to potential liability for perjury and marriage fraud, if there was no reason to do so. The same, although slightly different, rationale goes for Ducks agreeing to copy over that statement and sign it. Granted, he does allege that he had a separate motivation for wanting to be in this marriage, to hide his sexual orientation. But as the district court correctly pointed out, that just provides an additional reason. That doesn't undermine the claim that he engaged in marriage fraud that he signed in that statement.
Counsel, were the Yocom's counsel allowed to cross-examine TL?
No. To be fair, they only requested cross-examination of TL, to my understanding, in the first instance, in front of the BIA, which is not a fact-finding body. And so there would not have been a procedure there for cross-examining. That would have to be something that would be done back by USCIS as the original fact-finder in this procedural process. However,
but if they had asked for cross-examination of at the time that we're talking of, to the USCIS officer, how could that have been done in an interview?
At the time, sorry, Your Honor, just for clarification, are you talking about after the first marriage?
You indicated that at the second interview, right, they didn't ask for cross-examination of TL and the first officer, I can't remember her name, but how could that request have been granted by the USCIS officer in an interview?
In that interview, you're correct, that probably would not have been the best place to request it, but they could have requested it in response to the NOID, the Notice of Intent to Deny, or the amended Notice of Intent to Deny.
And whom would they have requested the right to cross-examine?
Well, according to their allegations, they sought to cross-examine TL and the USCIS officer.
Who could grant their request to cross-examine if they made a request after the receipt of the second NOID?
Presumably USCIS. That's my understanding how it was done under the Ching case.
You're representing UCIS. Tell me who in that agency could say, yes, give him a chance to cross-examine. And how would that be done in a courtroom, in a deposition? How would that be done?
Well, Your Honor, I think the confusion arises from the fact that this isn't part of the normal process. The only time a cross-examination has been ordered in this context to USCIS's knowledge is the Ching case.
Right.
And so this is...
How was that done there?
Well, there it, the court ordered, and so it was sent back, and USCIS conducted it after the court ordered it.
There was a demand, and there was a request in United States District Court, right?
In yes.
And isn't that what they've done here?
Here they, in District Court, they allege that they were denied cross-examination by the agency.
And they requested the right to cross-examine.
They claim that procedural due process requires them the right to cross-examine, but my reading of the complaint isn't that they want the district court, to handle the cross-examination, that they want the matter remanded to the agency for the cross-examination.
I think I'd be happy if the district court ordered an evidentiary hearing in which TL and the officer could be cross-examined in open court. Wouldn't you?
They probably agree. But there would be no legal rationale, no basis why they'd be entitled to such cross-examination.
Do you think the Ching case gives them that right?
No, Your Honor. Ching is distinguishable for several reasons. That case was based on a very unique and extreme set of facts where, in that case, the ex-spouse gave a statement suggesting marriage fraud years after the couple had divorced, and the individual who was applying for the green card for or the I-130 classification. He wasn't, excuse me, she, Ms. Chang, was not present when that statement was given, unlike here where Duke was present, excuse me, Duck, was present when TL gave the statement, and so knows the circumstances under which it was given. Further, in the Ching case, that statement by the ex-spouse was the only evidence of marriage fraud stacked against substantial other evidence that the couple lived together, had engaged in marital intimacy, and had substantial objective evidence that they had merged their lives.
But, counsel, can a couple live together with an intent to have a lifetime together without having sexual intimacy?
I believe so, Your Honor, and I'm sure there are cases that have found that. The test is only whether they intended to form a life together at the inception. So sexual intimacy would just be one indication among a whole constellation of indications as to whether the couple intended to form a life together when they were married.
So what's the problem here with the complaint from your perspective is how you think it does not allege in the complaint that they plan to have a life together?
Correct, Your Honor. They do not allege that they allege that they plan to form a life together, but that is a legal conclusory statement. The underlying factual material that they allege does not indicate that they intended to form a life together. And the district court was looking at the two sworn statements, and even if the court accepts Duck's discussion about how the USCIS officer looked at the pictures and he felt tremendously coerced to give this statement, none of the complaint's allegations suggest a plausible reason why TL would agree to give the same statement. Nor do the complaint's allegations overcome the paucity of objective documentary evidence that the couple had substantially merged their lives and assets like you see in other marriage fraud cases.
Did the plaintiff get an affidavit from TL about this?
No, Your
Honor. Saying he was coerced or anything like that?
No, Your Honor. And in other cases that involve marriage fraud, you sometimes see that where the former spouse writes a letter or signs an affidavit saying this was, this statement was obtained under these coercive or misunderstood reasons. Here, there was none of that, further indicating that there's no plausible reason why TL would have agreed to sign this statement under the penalty of perjury unless it was true.
Was the statement under penalty of perjury?
No, but it was a sworn statement, and so...
Maybe a sworn statement. I'm sorry, I read the statement. I didn't see any statement that she was said. I make the statement under penalty of perjury, or I swear to the truth of the statement. It's just a plain statement.
It is a sworn statement, though.
Who swore?
My understanding is that these statements are sworn statements.
What's the basis of that understanding? You think that every statement that's signed by a litigant is sworn? Anyway, I think you've answered my question by yourselves.
It was on an official government record in the I-130 application and withdrawal.
Part of the record. Okay.
Counsel, I have a further question for you, if I may please. Do you agree with your friend on the other side's contention that at this stage, when we have a pleading dismissed, that we have to take all reasonable inferences in favor of the claimant?
All plausible factual inferences, correct. Any legal conclusory claims that the court doesn't need to accept. And it's not just purely reasonable, it has to be a plausible inference.
Yeah, now, I also want to know this, if you mentioned that in other marriage fraud cases, there are often affidavits from parties stating what they intended to spend a life together or whatever. But in those cases, aren't those issues normally, don't they come up with that evidentiary record at the summary judgment stage and not on a motion to dismiss the pleadings?
Well, Your Honor, in these types of cases, actually, that evidence would almost always be produced before the agency to begin with, because of the unique way in which APA review is done. By the time it gets to the district court, the district court's already acting as an appellate review body, and so it's just reviewing the record amassed by the agency. And so here, if we were to go back down to the district court, the agency would just produce the administrative record, and that would be, you know, the entirety of everything that the decision maker below had looked at, and that's what would be the basis for summary judgment.
Okay, thank you, counsel.
Thank you. And so to go back to the original, I think we were talking about Ching. There, because that statement by the ex-spouse was the only evidence of marriage fraud stacked against all this other evidence, the risk of erroneous deprivation in that case was
Ching. The statement of the ex-spouse said that he'd been promised $32,000 but only received $14,000. So that is a basis for bias in his statement. But I don't see any basis for seeing a bias in TL's statement, do you?
I do not, Your Honor. And
I think that's a big distinguishing fact, isn't it?
It is. And I think in Ching, one of the reasons why the court said we can assume that there might be bias is that the statement was given after the couple had divorced. Here in this case, the statement was still given while TL and Duck were still married. And prior to TL's learning about Duck's sexual orientation based on the allegations.
As for the APA claim, that was done sua sponte, right?
Correct, Your Honor.
Anything wrong with that?
Well, ordinarily, if the court's going to dismiss sua sponte, it would provide notice and opportunity to respond. But this court's precedent has made clear that that's not necessary if there's no possible way that the plaintiff can prevail on the claims as they have alleged. And the district court here reasonably concluded that there was no possible way that the Yocoms could prevail. And that's the same reason why I denied leave to amend. That looking at the allegations as they existed, taking all of the selectively excerpted pieces of the record that the plaintiffs attached to support their position, the court concluded that there was nothing that could overcome these statements and lack of evidence of the couple substantially merging their lives together.
If TL had come forward either by deposition or affidavit and said this was done under coercion and it was all wrong, would this case continue on? But we don't have that. But what if he had done that or she had done that?
That's a good question, Your Honor. I can't really speculate because I guess we'd have to look at the circumstances and what TL actually said about the reason for the coercion. But as you point out, we don't have that here. We have no indication to think that TL was coerced in giving that statement. I see my time is
up.
Thank you very much.
Ms. Lynn, you've got a full 2 minutes. I'll put 2 minutes on. But before that starts, because I'd like to ask you a question, it occurred to me that the reason that Duck gave for the wedding to TL was that he wanted to marry a woman to keep the fact of his homosexuality secret from his parents, right?
That's correct.
Why didn't he marry a woman in Vietnam? I mean, he picked a woman in the United States. But why didn't he marry a woman in Vietnam? Is there any indication as to that?
I don't know the answer to that question. I do think what's important, though, is that the complaint alleges that his reasons for marrying TL were what makes a marriage bona fide, right, which is the intent to establish a life together. and that wanting to marry someone in order to establish a conventional life with them to hide one's sexual orientation does count as an attempt to establish a life with someone under the INA. And I would submit that that's what's really important here, is his reasons for marrying TL do count.
They could have been done by marrying a woman in Vietnam just as well, right? But, of course, then you wouldn't have a I-130 petition.
Well, before he had married TL, he had been in the U.S. for a period of time studying in school. And so, you know, he was here for a while and then ended up marrying TL. And the complaint does allege that while he was in the U.S., he did talk to his parents, who during that time pressured him to marry a woman. And so you have a situation where he's here in this country and his family is telling him, you know, we really want you to marry a woman.
Pardon me, I've taken up all your time with my questions, so why don't you give another 2 minutes so you can do her rebuttal correctly.
Thank you, Judge Maya. 3 points in rebuttal. First, this case really is just like Ching. In the Ching case, the court was clearly very worried that the immigration officers had gone to the ex-spouse's house, made some sort of threat or intimidation towards him, and that was a reason why there was a high risk of erroneous deprivation. Here, again, the complaint alleges, and those allegations must be taken as true, that there was a very serious threat made to Duck to out him to TL. As for the part in Ching...
What was the threat to TL?
Sorry, the threat was made to Duck to out him to TL. And then, as for the part in Ching about, you know, malice or jealousy, I think that that's relevant because the court thought that those were reasons why the ex-spouse might have succumbed to the threat. I think here you can infer that the reason why TL might have gone along with what the immigration officer was saying is that clearly the officer saw something on Duke's phone that, you know, made their marriage seem maybe less valid than TL had thought it was, and that was a reason why TL might have gone along with this officer's narrative. And so I don't think that that part of Ching is a reason to distinguish this case from that. I'll also just point out that here, too, the agency's marriage fraud determination rested on the statements, and that there was significant evidence of the marriage's bona fides in the record. There were joint tax filings, a bunch of evidence of joint commingled finances, evidence that they had met each other's parents, and that country conditions evidence supporting Duck's explanation that he married TL to hide his sexual orientation and appease his family. And then just very quickly on the request point that you were discussing with my friend on the other side, the government hasn't pointed to any requirement that you have to have made a request to USCIS in order to be able to raise it to the BIA. The general rule is that you just have to raise something before the agency proceedings end. And as Judge Bea was alluding to, I think, the USCIS proceedings are non-adversarial, and it would be extremely unusual to have an adversarial proceeding injected into those. We request reversal. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, and I want to compliment both counsel for their oral arguments. Thank you for a very pro bono. Thank you. The case of Yocom and Yocom versus the United States Citizenship Immigration Services 2355430 is submitted for decision, and that ends our calendar for today. Thank you very much, and we stand adjourned.